Good morning, everybody. If y'all can get on your feet with us. Alright, so as Myra usually says, let's fill this house with prayer, because we know prayer works, we know that prayer has power behind it, amen? Alright, so thank you, God, for another Sunday, Lord. We thank you, Jesus, that we get to be in your house, that we get to spend time with you today. Lord, we open our hearts to receive of your presence. We ask, God, that you would fill this room with your presence, that you would heal every heart that came in need of healing, that you would move in every need that is here today. We ask that you would just minister through pastor and minister through us, through music, and whoever's going to be teaching the youth. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so the verse I want to share with you guys is Luke 10:19. It says, I have given you authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and to overcome all the power of the enemy. Nothing will harm you. So, something that I feel that God's been teaching me in every season, not in just one season, is authority. You have authority. I have given you this authority. You haven't earned it. I don't have authority because of the works that I've done or because of the talents I have or anything like that. I have authority because Jesus has given me authority through his salvation. He's given me that authority. And it's in every season that he's given us authority. It's in every battle that we face. Over anxiety, we have authority. Over depression, we have authority. Over sickness, we have authority. Any battle that the enemy or any obstacle, really, that the enemy wants to place in front of you or that you're facing today, know that you have authority over that because Jesus has given you authority. When he rose from the grave, he proved that he had authority over sin and death, over the enemy. And the reason why we have authority is because we worship the King of Kings. We worship the Lord of Lords, and we worship the one who has all authority in his hands. So today when you worship and you sing to God, just give him glory for all that he's given you. But also sing with authority. Sing over the battle that you're facing today. Sing over the trial that you're going through. Sing over the depression, over the anxiety, whatever it may be. Sing over it with authority, knowing that Jesus has the victory. Amen? you are loved and you are chosen. So give him glory because of all that he's given you. Amen? Let's keep praising his name. Strongholds that have been there for too long. I ask that you would bring peace into the mind that is filled with anxiety, into the mind that is filled with chaos, Father God. I ask that you would bring peace, Lord Jesus, your peace that surpasses all understanding.
Thank you, Lord.
God, we thank you for your reckless love that constantly meets us at our lowest moments and at our highest moments. We thank you, Father God, because you lead us, Lord Jesus, in places where we have to rely. Where it's too deep for us to walk along. We thank you, Father God.
You called me out upon the waters, the great unknown, where fear may fail.
meet us there. But the most amazing thing, God, is that when you meet us at our lowest point, you don't leave us there. You don't leave us in our own dress. You don't leave us in our own sadness and our own sorrow, God. You reach out your hand and you lift us up. You dust us off and you clean up our mess, Father God, and you help us to change every single day, Lord Jesus. And that is reckless love. That is what reckless love is, Father. Lord, it is a love that breaks down walls. It is a love that breaks down strongholds, that breaks down sin in our lives. It is a love that purifies. Thank you, Jesus, for your love.
So
so blessed because of that love. You found this worst moment, Heavenly Father, and you didn't turn away. You extended your hand of love and mercy to bring us to this very day. We haven't walked alone. You walked with us, meeting our needs. And the day we come into your presence, Lord, to prepare our minds, our hearts to receive the challenge of word. We know that we live in a different time, but it's the same word. We pray, Lord, that your word will come like a light into our darkness, like our strength and our weaknesses, like the authority, Lord, that will take us to a higher ground. We've come to be blessed. We've come to seek your face. We come for you to speak to us, Heavenly Father. So now use this vessel as I challenge the minds and hearts of those that are presently here in your house, the ones watching over Facebook. God, there is no limitation to where you're at. You're here, you're there, you're everywhere. And today we combine our spirit, our faith, our belief in you, and we ask that you speak. In the precious name of Jesus Christ, we call it done. Amen, amen, amen. How many can say good amen?
Amen.
All right, little, maybe a God bless one to people around you, and then you may be seated.
They don't want me to sound like a woman. You mean listen to my kind.
Because I don't think this one isn't working very good, is it?
That one's not working very good, right?
No.
Well, good. I have this in my hand. That way, if I can bring it a little back and throw it to somebody, right? So make sure you're paying attention today to what we have to share with you. So as the youth goes into the youth chapel, the youth have their services over there. And then we that are called the more experienced, we sit here and receive the word of God. How many came expecting something good to happen to us? I'm going to come with an open heart, an open mind, an open disposition, knowing that God indeed is going to speak to our lives. More now than ever, I believe that the challenge God has laid upon my heart to prepare the hearts and minds and educate our people for the end time of their lives. To come to realize that we're here today and we're gone tomorrow. You might say, well, what really enlightened you this week, Pastor? What really motivated you to continue this teaching that you felt was so important to the church? Well, the motivation was the following. Monday and Tuesday, I worked the funeral for the Diaz family. Then I was home in the car, really. The phone rang, and it was a funeral home. And they said, can you do a 9:30 on Friday morning? Okay, I got you covered. I got the night. I'll do 9:30 for you. A few minutes later, the phone rings again. It's another funeral home. And I said, well, if you need me for Friday, I have a service at 9:30. Oh, good, because I need you at 1 o'clock. I said, okay, I'll be there. A couple of hours later, the phone rings, and it's the other funeral home. Pastor, I said, if you're calling to ask for some help for Friday, I've got a 9:30, I've got a 1 o'clock. Oh, good, this one's at 6 o'clock. So you can imagine where I spend my Friday. Dealing with families that are hurting. They're going through difficult times. And especially the evening service, the memorial service for candlelights, where all the kids, they brought all the pictures of all the children who had died. And their parents were there, and I got a chance to nourish their lives. I thought, now more than ever, I need to take care of the living. The living need to get a clear cut look at what the gospel really says. I started this about wake-up calls, calling wake-up calls. Because this all along since the pandemic, so I keep telling you, it's a wake-up. God is calling to our lives. And now more than ever, I think we need to realize that even though we said the beginning message of this content, of this series that I'm preaching, I remember saying to you last week, people say, well, Pastor, times have passed. Things are different. We need something different in our walk. And I say, well, you know what? In life, a lot of things are going to change. Many things will change. But the only thing that's never going to change is going to be the Word of God.
Amen.
So therefore, we need to apply the Word of God to our living. We need to bring our life into conformity, to be able to conform what the Word of God says. You can't bring the Word of God to conform to you. You've got to conform to it. That's the way it works. When it's all said that it was gone, it was given to you not to for you to flex or move it in the direction you wanted, but to use it in the context given to your life to make you a better person. I promise you one thing, that once you believe the Word of God and you leave the Word of God, God is going to open the windows of heaven. He's going to bless you in a special way. It's important that we understand, wake up. And what creates wake-up calls, Pastor, especially in the Christian world? Complacency. A lot of times we go to our Christian walk, and let me just ask a question. How many have served the Lord more than 5 years? Have been a Christian more than 5 years? More than five. More than 10? More than 20? More than 30? And says, well, that's crazy. I'm really 30, Pastor. You know, what I'm trying to say is this. Don't allow all the years you spend in church to have you kick back and say, I got this. I got it made. There's a battle going on for your soul. And Satan is not going to stop until the day you die. Trying to steal from you the joy of your salvation. Trying to bring you into his fold to understand that. And if we sit back as believers because we think we have it made, no, we're still in the battle. We don't have it made. The greatest deceiving lie, the enemy to your life, he said, you got it, don't worry about it. You got it made. Because we understand one thing. It's a daily walk with Jesus Christ. Amen. Life is a school in itself. There's lessons to be learned, so many different lessons in life. And every time, we might be going through a similar problem, but there's a different solution because God's in control of all things. And that's the reason why we come to the Word of God. Then we refocus. Then we sit for a moment as we receive the Word of God, challenge Father, and say, okay, where am I? And the light which being spoken, where am I? What part of this applies to who I am, what I'm going through, and what I need for my life? But we can do this, people, and we do this on a consistent basis. Every day, a walk with Jesus, we stay focused, we stay determined, we stay believing who Jesus Christ is. Our joy and salvation will continue us. We won't allow discouragement or sadness or tragedy in life to take us down, because we know the greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. And in this time, people, when we feel that our world is falling apart, that we need to refocus. Then God kind of stops and just a moment and says, okay, where did I lose him? Where did I go wrong? See, our greatest deterrent, I think, in our lives many times is that we don't like to be wrong. We just don't like to be wrong. Even when you said in the past, and we're driving a car, and the policeman pulls us over and says, you know why I stopped? You say, no, what did I do? And you know you ran the red light. You know you did that. And you're like, oh, no, I have no idea why you stopped me, really. Officer, really? We don't like to be at fault. So therefore, it's time to stop and reflect and understand. How many understand that nobody's perfect? And that we don't have it made. The moment we feel we have it made, we've let down our guard. The moment we've said, I got this, and don't get ready to fight the next battle, we get ready for defeat. That's why it's important that we awaken the church that believes in Jesus Christ. Wake up call to believe. Well, why, Pastor? Why do we need wake up calls? How many wake up calls in your life? And God has a way to wake you up. God will find a way to wake up. See, he came that you might be found, not lost. He came to save you, not to condemn you. And he will use any means possible to get your undivided attention. Get this? Undivided means what, Tasha? Not only Sunday morning, every day of your life, he walks with you, lead and guide. He wants you to stay focused. He wants you to believe. He wants you to walk forward. He wants you to be determined in the things you do in life. So therefore, why do we need wake-up calls? First of all, I want to share with you why we need these wake-up calls. We need wake-up calls because of the condition of the world that we live in today. I want to take you with me to 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 2 through 4. When he uses a premise, and we've talked about this initially, and I'm just telling everybody, this is Paul. He's about to end his ministry. It's about to call it, I'm done. I've done my share of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Timothy, you're next. I'm giving you advice. I'm going to cue you into everything that's going to happen. I want you to understand that even though you're at the head, you're running the whole show, you're going to run the show now, Timothy, understand something. There's no glory at being at the top. People expect too much out of you, and sometimes you expect too much out of people. You got to balance the boat. You got to understand that when I show you the other side of the coin, you've seen blessing, you've seen prosperity, you see what God can do, you watch miracles happen to me, but I got to show you the other side of the coin, because every life has two sides. And we get to the other side, you're going to deal, I'm coming to understand that even though you are dealing with people that come to church, it doesn't mean that they're perfect by any means. It means there's still going to be deficiencies, there's still going to be attitudes, there's going to be difficult times in their life that you have to deal with. So it's educating. He says, when all this is going wrong, this is what I want you to do. My first advice to you is this, in the midst of that. Let's start this by saying, preach the word and be ready, in season and out of season. He says, the solution to all the issues you have is to preach the word of God. The Word of God is the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's not a philosophy. It's not a concept. It's the truth of Almighty God. So when you stand and you speak to people, speak under the authority of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Be vested. Be founded. Let everything that flows from your mouth be filled with power and authority of the Word of God. We don't need personal concepts. We don't need personal ideas. We don't need you to make people feel good. We need you to teach them the truth, and the truth will set them free. You need to preach with authority, with a commitment in your heart, and like I was told always, and I tried to do everything to place it in my mind. He said, stand here and preach like it's the last time in your life you're going to preach. Like you'll never get another chance. For you never know whether it's me or you or someone listening to this message, their life might come to an end during this coming week. Say, do it with a passion, prepare yourself, be committed, be strong, because the Word of God edifies. The Word of God builds you up. The Word of God lifts you up. God extends His hand of love and mercy. And we're walking through a trying time. It's the Word of God. See, I stand at countless funerals. I tell people, I stand here to bring the Word of God to comfort your life. This man cannot comfort your life, but the one I represent, Jesus Christ, King of kings and Lord of lords, He will bring comfort and strength and direction for you in your trying time. We need to go there and understand that we open the Word of God and we see that the first thing you told Timothy, the first thing you need to do, you need to preach the Word of God. In season and out of season, means what? Be ready all the time. Be ready all the time, because as you walk through life, you'll confront different issues with different people in different places. Be ready. To preach is to teach. To teach is to share. See, you don't need a pulpit to preach. How many know that the moms are really good about teaching at home? They're good about teaching at home. And they know how to apply it and everything, you know? But see, what he's saying is this. There's going to be issues that don't happen in church. There's going to be issues that are going to happen at work at different places. And there, you have an open door to share the Word of God. Preach it in season and out of season. As a leader, as a head, Timothy, teach your people to do this. If we can raise an army of men and women to do this very thing, they will be able to touch a lot of lives. Because when you see a lot of people, the only time they hear the gospel from a pulpit is on a Sunday morning. But if the people take the word with them wherever they go, then the word will spread. It goes beyond a Sunday morning experience in church. It goes to an everyday walk with Jesus Christ. And I've told you countless times, a lot of times people would rather hear you than to hear me. A lot of people that are not believers in Jesus Christ, you say, hey, let me call this. Oh, no, not the pastor. Don't call the pastor. They don't even know me, but still say, no, don't call the pastor. See, that's why it's my job. To instill into the mind of hearts of each and every one of you that you've been called to serve. As if we believe that one of the teachings we received on Wednesday night with Brother Molina and taught us about, and he said, go to all the world and preach the gospel. And he then conditioned it to the disciples that everybody has been called to serve. Everybody has a world to minister in. Everyone has lives they can touch. A lot of people can initiate conversation and the knowledge of Jesus Christ to people that really need it. The people that most need it don't come to church. The most people that need that gospel, that love, that understanding, a word of comfort and strength are not going to be sitting in a congregation. They're going to be at your work. They'll be a neighbor. They'll be a family member that will come to church. And you've been called to preach the word in time. I'm seeing as you know, I want you to preach the word. With what type of mindset? I love the way what follows in that scripture. He tells them how to do it. I mean, I when I saw this, I never saw, and I hope your Bible says the same as mine. I never saw anything that sugarcoats us. Nothing says, be loving and kind and understand. Look what he says. I want you to do this. He says, when you do this, you preach the word out. I want you to convince. Means what? Sell your product. Sell it. Let them believe what you believe in. He said, I want you to, your first job when you preach the Word of God, teach the Word of God, you need to convince them. You've got to show them that you have the truth. They need to see in you and through you what you're saying, that there's power, there's story, and there's direction for their life. He says, not only that, rebuke, which means what? Straighten them up. Don't be afraid to tell me you're wrong. He says, I want you to rebuke them, because a lot of times the best way to get people's attention is to rebuke. He said, you know what? This is not right. You got to stop and look. He said, not only rebuke, but he says, I want you to exhort them with all long-suffering and teaching. That after you go after them, after you teach them, after you speak to them, after you set the record straight, he says, now be ready, because it's not going to happen overnight. Long-suffering means be patient in God's time. See, understand sometimes when we venture out to do something for God, we want to see instant production. want to see it happen right now. No, Pastor, I give up because, you know, I invite my neighbor to come to church. I mean, twice. I don't give up on that. Well, how many times do I have to invite you before you came? How many times did it take for you to be convinced? Some of you didn't have a church, like David didn't have a church. He was a pastor's son. He was in church. I'm talking about people that have choices in life. Did you give me the church, any neighbor, ever? He said, well, you don't understand that. He said, be patient. Be patient. A lot of times you got to let the word just kind of sink in. And the truth just sink in. Because a lot of times when you speak truth to people, it kind of angers them. And takes a little while and say, you know what, that was right. You know, that was good. And I think I'd like to apply it in something that we can understand. How many of you the famous Bengay in the past? It smells awesome, doesn't it? When you use Bengay, everybody knows you have Bengay. When you first apply it, it's there. As you give it time and it heats up and begins to get into the system, and see, that's what we're about to ask. The wake-up call said, hey, it's over here. There's going to be a little time for them to react. So don't be discouraged. Bottom line is this. A lot of people say, well, what if I do this and people don't react? Well, you weren't called for a reaction. You were called to share. The rest belongs to God. Your venue and my venue is to share the word of God to the people. Give them the gospel of Jesus Christ. Open up your heart, open up their minds, and you share. The result belongs to God and the person. But your job is to initiate it by sharing the word of God and being convinced and staying in the fold, finding a way to get their undivided attention. If you really care for people and their eternity, stop and think, where would they spend your eternity if you keep your mouth shut? What's going to happen to them? What would you do on judgment day when they don't make it? And you're present to watch that judgment, and they look at you and say, you never told me. We were good friends and you never told me. We were family and you never really invited me. You kind of called it respect and you backed away. See, a lot of times we need to understand there's a time and place for everything. I understand that. But when the time comes, let it go. I tell people, I'm invited to speak to people. Sometimes they say, hey, come speak, someone's going to be at the house, all that stuff. And I walk in. I don't walk in with a two-ton Bible. I don't walk in with bumper stickers. I just walk in. And we talk about everything. I will never lead anybody into religious talk or into Bible talk. I will never take you there. But when you take me there, you're not coming out. I want you to feel you took me there. You took me there, let's go. And then you shut the door behind you and there you go. Because the first thing you have to win that person's confidence. They need to believe in who you are and what you're representing at that moment. They need to know you're an everyday person with everyday experiences and experience Jesus Christ, and they need that Christ. That's what it's about. Being able to be educated in the way we do things and not to despair. Never, never give up on anybody until you go to their funeral. Once you go to their funeral, then there's nothing else you can do. But in the meantime, be there, in season and out of season. That they might say, man, when somebody looks to heaven and hear them say, man, thank you for being a pain. Thank you for being so diligent in my desire. Because I know you sit here today, and I look around to the families that are here today. Some of you have a lot of family members that do not know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. They know of him, but they don't know him. And we have a challenge before us. If you love him, find a time, find a place, minister to their needs. And yes, I understand. A lot of times, the worst person to speak to a family member is another family member, because if you're not living right to look, you don't have much to understand them. But the bottom line, make yourself today worthy to be able to share the love of Jesus Christ with people. Cleanse your mind and your heart. Put away all the things that can create havoc, division, and strife within your life and within the people that surround you. And begin to share the love of Jesus Christ. The love of Jesus Christ has no barriers. The love of Jesus Christ has power. He said, I want something dynamic. There's nothing more dynamic than the love of God.
Amen.
There's nothing more powerful than God's patience and understanding. But God's patience and understanding is not a license to prolong the thing. It's just a venue to understand. It's never too late to come to Jesus Christ. He said, I want you to do this. And then Timothy would say, well, why? Why? Look what it says. See, we're not living that right now. It says, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. The time is going to come. They don't want to hear it. They don't want to hear about righteous living. They don't want to hear about holiness. They don't want to talk about the things that make you a better person than Jesus Christ. They're kind of like, really? Really? Things have changed. There's going to come that sound doctrine is going to suffer. But according to their own desires, because they have itching ears. Itching ears means they want to hear what they want to hear. See, and that's what we find a lot of times. And especially when God speaks your life and you know it's God, you kind of want to shut it off. That's not what I wanted to hear. That's not what I needed from. No, that's what we need for our lives. Our itching ears brings us to selective hearing. We hear what we want to hear, not what we need to hear in life. When you're a believer in Jesus Christ, you better train your ears to listen to what God has to say to your life. Be able to apply the word of God to your life and move forward. Because itching ears will take you away from Christ. Itching ears is a thing of the flesh. It's a thing that's seeking an easy way in your walk through life. Itching ears are where they say, oh, it's okay. God understands. God is merciful. I hear a lot of that from people. So, well, anyway, God's a loving, merciful God. But he's also a just God. Amen. Don't you ever forget that. He's not only loving and enduring and patient. Is not only the grace of God, but also the justice of God. God says, it comes to here. And then it comes the time that we got to put this thing into place. Change in perspective. He said, itching ears will lead you to find something easy and not something that is right. And today we find this in so many venues. How a lot of ministries are trying to teach an easy way to heaven instead of the right way. Who doesn't want an easy way? We want an easy way about everything. I mean, easy way in everything. A lot of people, let's talk about different ways. We talk about easy ways, convenient ways of doing things, you know. There's people that do a lot of coupons. Let me see the hands of all the ones that do coupons. Out of the newspaper. Let me see. I want to see who I won't stand behind in line. And I stand in line behind some guys that really start flipping all these coupons. Like, okay, it's 2 cents. Lady, I'll give you the 2 cents, just call them. But no, that's the way I do things, that's the way I save money, and you'll be surprised, okay. Everybody's away. Trying to find a better way. That's a simple explanation I'm trying to tell you. In your Christian walk, there is no simple way, there's only one way.
Amen.
There is no simple way, people. There's no alternative. There's only one way, and Jesus Christ said it. In John chapter 14, he said, not that your heart be troubled, believe in God, believe also in me. He's speaking to a Jewish congregation that has not accepted him as Messiah. And he's telling them, I am God. I am the extension. I am the deity of the Trinity. You believe in God with me, you believe in Jehovah, believe also in me. And then he shows his deity by saying, in my Father's house are many mansions. He's saying, there's a Father and then there's me. If we were not told, we would have told you, I go to prepare a place of right now, you shall also be.
Thank you,
Lord. And he goes about coming back to see him, that kind of stuff. And then he says, and you know the way. And you know, people, a lot of times, we're so good about looking at the negative of people. I mean, I want you to see that scripture later on, if you want. Now, John in chapter number 14, when Jesus tells them, and you know the way. And wow, check it out. In the midst of a big congregation, of hundreds of people being there, only one has the courage to speak up. Only one. And who was it? It was Thomas. Doubting Thomas, hello. The one that we all remember just as Doubting Thomas. He didn't believe he had risen from the dead. It was Thomas that said, Lord, we don't know the way. Isn't it awesome when people ask because they want to learn? Everybody else said, oh, not it. No. He says, no, I don't have it. And I'm sure there's a bunch of others here that don't have it either, but they're ashamed to raise their hand. So on behalf of them and thousands and millions that will live after me, what are you talking about? What are you talking about? And verse number 6 of chapter 14 of John, Jesus said, I am, who? I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no man comes to the Father but by me. Do we have that strength? Do we understand that? He said, I am the way. As you go through life, you have a choice. You've been given free will. There's a right way and a wrong way to do things, and it's your fault. The Bible speaks about it, and there is a path that takes us into eternity. There is a path that wants to want to lead a righteous life. Why is it saying narrow? Because our flesh desires a lot of things. It reduces our choices. It says, keeps us focused on the direction that we're going. We go from a four-lane freeway to a one-lane street. One of those, like, how many have been to Santa Fe, New Mexico before? Okay, that kind of street. Right. He said, narrow is the path, which means what? Because without Jesus, you can do nothing. But if Jesus is with you, it's narrow, but you're not walking alone. He's going to walk with you. The other one is why? Anybody can walk it. Anybody can walk the other road. But it leads to eternal condemnation. He said, do you understand? I am the way. You follow me, get on the narrow road, and I will open a path, and you will be blessed. I am the way. I am the truth. And if there's something, and we'll later on this message, we're going to talk about truth. But I ask you, why did he say I am the truth? What was so important about truth? Let me take you real quick. All the way back to Genesis. Man fell from grace because they fell from truth. They believed a lie and they fell from truth. And what he's saying, I am the one that's going to fix that. I'm fixing that mistake that was done. I am the truth. I'm coming to erase all that venue, all the way to today, to understand that I am truth. I've come. I made man in perfection. I made him to be the crown of creation. They fell from grace, and I come to justify. I come to prepare a way. I've come to make a combination. I've come to bring you back into the fold. I want you to understand that, yes, you did fall to falsehood, to a lie, but today there's life in Jesus Christ. So I'm going to bring you in the direction you need to go. You're going to walk in the righteous path because I am truth and I am the life. Was it he that said in John 10:10, I have come that you might have life and have it in abundance? Yes. And like I've shared countless times, believe me, I've done it. And every single one of them, kind of want to remember, remind people, God promised life, he didn't promise years. That's all he promised you life. He didn't tell you how many years. How many have been blessed with years? Yeah. I got 73 of them. I think there's a lot of people nowadays that are like on the Apollo's top down. They no longer go up, they're starting to go back down. You know? How old are you? Well, that's why I was 49, and this year I'm 48. Going the other way. But see, God promised you life.
Amen.
And as I showed people, they just showed you real quick, just to kind of remind you. When I was called into an emergency one time, family called me and said, Pastor, we're on our way to the hospital. Things do not look good. Can you come? They told me where. I got my car, she took off. And I walked into that room. That person had gone, but it was alive. As I walked in the room, I saw the pain in all their faces. And I stood there. See, because a lot of times you get comfort, like, what do I, what? After so many years, what? Oh. And I thought, you know, because I stand there and think, come on, watch you. I thought, you know, God, to tell these people it was the will of God, that's right, it's correct, it was the will of God. But they need something else. They need something else at that time. They know it was the will of God, but something else they can hold on to. Something all that kind of makes sense to everything. And when I correct it, I'm like, God, give me something. I mean, I didn't just want to say to the family, it was the will of God, let's pray. What can I share? And that's why we have the Holy Spirit to enlighten us. And right away it came. It said, share with them. Man is a slave of time. We have a birth and we have a death. We are governed by the calendar and by the clock. By your appointments that you have to do, because that's who you are. You're a slave to that. You're bound to that situation. And me, I'm God, I'm eternal. I have no calendar, I have no clock. I don't measure life by years. I measure two missions. I send the world into, a person to this world to complete their mission, and once their mission is done, I call them home. That's why I preach at children's funerals, teenagers, adults, golden age. Because God didn't promise years, He promised life. He said, and I am the life. Then in the life that God has given you, yes, you could call it very much yours. But the bottom line, you are given one, you're here for one purpose. We achieve many things in life. We make a lot of choices in life. But the only one important thing to make is determine where you're going to spend your eternity. And I'm going to give you life. And in that life, I'm giving you the opportunity to find your Lord and Savior. What you do with it is totally up to you. The closest people to you that love you the most can't save you. There's only one Savior, and that's Jesus Christ. Amen. He talks about a commitment made to Him, that we have made to Him, and begin that walk toward heaven. But we're not there yet. And if ever we need it, God, we need Him now. As we look around to everything that's going on, you watch the news, it just gets worse and worse and worse and worse. It's not getting better, people. It's not getting better. It's getting worse. Oh, my God. If ever we need it, God, we need Him now. It's not time to doubt. It's not time to say, oh, my God. No, it's time. Okay, God, you're in control of all things. To walk, determine, and understand. In this life, we can confront issues that are difficult. We'll go through tragedy and different things. But my God can. My God will. And my God will deliver us from all affliction, all pain. He didn't call us to condemnation. He didn't call us to defeat. He didn't call us to walk away from us. He didn't call you to be an orphan. He called you to be the son and daughter of a living and powerful God. That's what we're called to be. And that's what He wants you to be. That's what He wants you to understand. He says, because engineers are going to say, which is the easy way to go to heaven? Oh no, your pastor is old school. He's hellfire condemnation. No, it's not condemnation. It's word of God. Amen. You're learning to adjust your life and to mold your life according to God's will. Engineers will say, I really don't need that. Engineers allows you to choose instead of the word of God to guide you. Itching ears looks for convenience. How many people watching this today have been seeking convenience? Oh, we need to go back. Don't be discouraged. Don't measure the truth by numbers. Some people say, well, that's a big church. Maybe that's why they're speaking the truth. It's not about numbers. It's about you and God and nobody else.
Amen.
That's what it's determined. Because yes, you can have big churches that are preaching truth, and that's why they're being blessed. You also have a lot of churches that are big because it's convenient. Because if you accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, you can live like the devil the rest of your life. You're going to heaven anyway because you're already saved. And that's convenient. That is convenient. If that was a way of life, I want that one. That's easy. Accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. That's why I got to that. God understands He's loving and merciful. That's all the Bible teaches. That's all He teaches. That's why we need to understand. When we select a place, a ministry to feed our lives, make sure it's Bible-based. Make sure it's not a concept of, well, it's a little bit different. No, it's not different. It's got to be like it is.
Amen.
The only way the Word of God works is when you use it in the context that it was meant. That's the only way it's going to work. So if you're in Jesus Christ, we've got to go there. He says, ancient years, they're going to come up trying to, and they're going to raise a lot of people wanting to do this. And there'll be teachers, there'll be people, and there tells us about with 18 years, they will keep themselves teachers, and they will turn from the ears away from the truth and be turned on to fables. Fables are just stories, something that sounds good. Oh, that sounds good, that sounds reasonable. That sounds like something I want to do. Well, is it something you want to do or something you're supposed to do? See, that's the difference. To have the courage, to, even though you're a believer in Jesus Christ, to have the courage and make sure that's what God wants and not what you want. Going to heaven is not a convenience, it's a blessing.
Amen.
And a blessing is ultimate for every believer in Jesus Christ. So as you and I as believers, we need to choose that. Make that choice and come to understand there's a lot of things that sound good, but because they sound good and they don't have Bible principles, they're not right. And we need to be smart enough to understand that. We need to be able to stop. But it's my best friend. Your best friend is Jesus Christ. Your best friend cannot supersede the guidance of the Holy Spirit and what God teaches for your life. He's dealing with your life. So as a believer in Jesus Christ, don't seek for the easy way. Seek for the righteous way in Jesus Christ. To understand that indeed He is the way, the truth, and the life. And no man comes to the Father but me. Once I understand this, the word, Pastor, I want you to understand the mindset we have to correct. Go what to go with Proverbs chapter number 14, verse number 12. Right? This is really the mindset of a lot of people today. Check this one out if it didn't click. Alright, you ready for this? There's a way that seems to be right to a man, but the end of the way is death. There's things in your life that you love to say, hey, this is pretty good. This is right. I'm doing harm to nobody, I'm doing this, I'm being. He says, there's things that to you seem right. There's things that will be introduced into your life that sound good. He says, but the end result is death. It sounds good. It looks good, but it's not good. And you have, he says, Pastor, well, how do I determine that? That's why the Holy Spirit came. The Bible said the Holy Spirit will lead you to all truth. Where is God leading your life? How is God speaking to your person? Who are you listening to get advice? Just because it sounds good? You know? I'm very leery. Honestly speaking, I'm very leery of the famous phrase a lot of people have heard. Maybe they've used it in your life. You ever heard this one? The Lord told me to tell you this. You ever heard that one before? God told me to tell you this. No, I get a lot of those. And what do? Rebuke them? No, I listen. It works better in Spanish. El Señor me dijo que te diera. El Señor García, el Señor Martín, el Señor López, el Señor. What Lord told? Can we tell you something? When God speaks your life, you're going to know who is God. When someone speaks to you and says, God told me to share this with you, you're going to know it's God. Why? Because He's going to nail things you're going through. They're going to hit right on exactly what's going on in order to bring hope. See, because God speaks to edify. That's what God speaks for. To make you a better person. That's what He speaks for. And He will use individuals. Don't misunderstand me. I've had people come to me and thus says the Lord. And believe me, you don't know this. I'm not going to do it. It'll take us forever to do that. About the Linden man that walked into my life and gave me a one, thus saith the Lord. And initially I thought, nah, this man just wants money. Driving a beat up car, you know. It's Sunday afternoon. You're looking for $10 for gas or whatever, you know. That's what he wants. That's what my eyes said. When he walked up to his pastor of the church, he said, yeah, guess what? In my mind, good guess. Because he hadn't spoken to me yet. Then he said, let me just tell you how I got to you. Never seen the man in my life. He gave me the story how he got to me. So I'm here now. And this is what the Lord asked me to share with you. And we get to speak, I mean, the church just started running. Because He told me something that I said to nobody, I said to myself. Something on a Sunday morning, not as many people as I thought should have been in church right there. I was on my way to the funeral home to go with the family and come back into the night and go back to the home and do their service. And on the way to home, I says, maybe it's over. Maybe they need another pastor. They need somebody better. I said it to nobody. I said it to myself. And when that little man spoke, he said, you said to yourself today, maybe this should be. And as soon as he said that, I mean, the tears just started to flow. He said, no, your time is not done yet. In that moment, the kids got to the church, said, those are your children. No, I wouldn't say a big guess. No, I'm like, yes, it's God. Because all I see you and your kids running through green pastures. God wants to bless you. Then he turns and says, right there, empty spot in the big parking lot we had there, you will build a big church. A big building we built there for the honor of the glory of God. This is what I have to show you. And then at that time, I told you before, there was no loans. It was during the time there was no loans for church and stuff like that. Long story short, it happened.
Amen.
It happened. because God said. What do I do with when people say, God, when you tell me this, give it time. Time proves all things. And the thing that I found in my life when someone comes to tell me, the Lord told me to tell you this, I give it time. I don't change my lifestyle. I don't change anything about me. I keep living because if it came to me, it came to me to who I am. And then if it's of God, it happens. And if it's not of God, it's a good experience. We move on. I don't live and die. That's the way I live and die my Christian walk. It's a good way that sometimes God gives wake-up calls. But that's why Jesus sent me the Holy Spirit. To lead me to all truth. To lead me where I need to be. To lead me where He wants to bless me. And that experience, my friend, is a 24/7. God told me to say this to you. It's not going to happen every day. Just trust the relationship of God. Believe what God is doing for your life. And then it needs me. Then if you really need a wake-up call, then He'll send some. Just a reminder, hey, I've been talking to you. I've been trying to tell you, you're not listening. Listen, this is what's up. See, these are things that are important in life. He says, because there's a lot of things that you do in life. They look good. They seem like it's going to be okay. There's nothing wrong with it. I'm not hurting anybody with it. But see, it's not about hurting people. It's about hurting yourself. Making choices to what my eyes like. Instead of what my heart says is true. Yeah, that's why we make so many wrong decisions. But then it says, there's a thing in life that you choose that looks good. This one be that the end result is destruction. Why does that happen, church? Why does that happen? Because we didn't see the leading of the Holy Spirit. It just felt good. See, that's what I mean about our generation. Our generation has walked away from holiness, from sanctification, from respect, to over whatever happens this Sunday. That's where we're at. And that's why we're in the condition that we're at. That's why the church is hurting. Because the believers have gone onto automatic pilot instead of a passion to serve the Lord Jesus Christ. Once we return to passion, good things are going to happen. Then we get to, I got about more scripture to show you real quick before I finish. So what is it you have to watch out for? Book of 2 Timothy 3:13. He says, but evil men and impostors will grow worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. As time goes on, the impostors will get up. There's a lot of wolves being dressed in the suits of the Lamb, leading people in the wrong direction, teaching a more convenient gospel. He said, they're going to abound. Oh, God, oh no, it's part of the course. When we get into signs of the second coming of Jesus Christ, we're going to find out. First thing he says, many will come in my name, saying that they are. And before I go any further, I just heard somebody preach the other day, up to this present time, there's been over 3,000 spiritual leaders that have led people astray. Imposters. It seems like they have the truth. It sounds good, but it's not. And so the bottom line is this. They don't only deceive you, they deceive themselves. So the bottom line is this. As you go through life, the biggest person, if you choose to say lies, the person that gets hurt the most by lies is you. It all comes back to you anyway. It's all said and done. So he says, in deceiving life, as you go through deceiving people, will cross your path. And you'll be able to identify. You're going to find out who they are, like really quick. Then he says, you need to realize, you need to kind of go there. I need to show what two more scriptures before I bring this to an end. Why don't you go with me to Ephesians chapter 5, verses 6 and 7. Let no one deceive you with empty words, but because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. Therefore, do not partner with them at all. When we become people, he says, have nothing to do with them. Absolutely nothing. I've heard people say, well, let me see and hear. A lot of times, the more you hear, the more confused you become. Once something says, cut them off. You don't need them in your life. be that drastic, be that conscious of your eternity, be that smart of your eternity. There's people that come in the name of the Lord that you need to cut off. People who will deceive you, that will lie to you, will bring you, like I said, a convenient way. The Bible says, cut them off. That's not Christ-like. No, Christ-like is to stand up for the truth. If they will stand in the truth, it's time to cut them. Do not allow them to interfere with your life, to influence your life, to influence your decisions. No, you don't need that. You need the Lord Jesus Christ. And the last one is more challenging to all. What am I to do, Pastor, when this happens? Ephesians 4:14. I could preach a sermon off of each one of these texts. I think you realize that, right? We're going to finish with that. That we should no longer be children, tossed to and fro, and be carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the trickery of men, and the cunning craftsmanship of deceitful plotting. He says, be no longer a child. Be no dark child anymore. Stop this. What do we have to do? He says, stop being going back and forth. Stop it. Stop it. And why you go back and forth is because you keep lending me ear. You keep trying to find something different. So no. No. I've told people over the years, how many believe that we serve a perfect God?
Amen.
I mean, how many really believe you serve a perfect God?
Amen.
How many believe that God loves you?
Amen.
Don't you think that when God places you in a place of worship, he didn't make a mistake? He brought you here for a reason.
Amen.
He has you listening to this teaching for a reason. There's many other options, but he chose you and chose me to be part of your life. There's a reason why he's a perfect God. He said, and what's the deal that you're jumping back and forth? I place you where you need to be. Kind of set down your roots and begin to grow. Don't be moved around here and there. Don't be deceived by going here and there and anywhere else. No, no. He said, because you're walking away from sound doctrine. You're letting the winds and the influence of family and friends lead you away from where I want you. He said, you can't allow that to happen. He said, you need to take conviction. You need to stand up. He said, no, I'm done. I know where I'm at. And you go forward. He said, learning once again. He said, that we should no longer be children tossed by and going to and fro and being carried about with every wind of doctrine. He says, stand up what you believe in and live it. Don't allow people to make choices for you, especially when it comes to your eternity. Today we stand at the crossroad of our lives. We have the opportunity today to make choices and to come to say, you know, God, you're speaking to us for a reason. There's things that you've laid in the heart of pastor to share with us. And I think we've been very clear this morning with the word of God. I think the scripture has been very clear to you as to what you need to do in your Christian walk. And we don't stand here and judge other people. We hear and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. The intent of what I've done here today for your life, and with our president was watching over Facebook, was to educate you in the word of God. To teach you the intent God has for your life. And when we talk about your eternity, listen to God and not the gospel. Listen for what's right and not what's convenient. Let me share something really special with you. When you go for what's right, God will bless you.
Amen.
He will bless you abundantly. So don't go over here trying to find what you already have here. Don't. It's not about how quick can I get it. It's going to be awesome when God sends it to me. Because then I learn to trust in God, to believe in God. And for all you've been seated here, some have not been here over the 5 years. That doesn't matter. What's important is that you understand. It's not about the time, it's about the moment. And to understand that God has tremendous blessings for your life when you do it His way. His way. Not convenient, His way to go forward. Not to be deceived, not to have itching ears, but to be focused.
you believe that this morning, this was for you. Amen. It will help to educate you. Then I want you to stand and pray and confirm and say, God, this is mine. This really puts things in perspective. Allows me to see how things really are. You've opened my eyes this morning to what I'm supposed to do with my Christian walk. And allow me to see that it's not everything that I see. Just because it glows, it's not gold. Not because it sounds pretty, isn't the truth. For I will know the truth, and the truth will set me free. Heavenly Father, we stand in your presence. Because you've been so good. So good to the Lord, you blessed us in so many different ways. Throughout the years, for those that are here and standing in this congregation, they've experienced who you are. They found, Lord, as they walked through life, that there were times, yes, there were times they got kind of desperate because they were human. But you know why they're still here, Lord? Because you came through. God, the moment came of need, and when the moment, the hour was upon us, you gave it to us. You blessed us. So we know we're standing in the truth. Allow us, Lord, to remain in the truth. To stay focused, to go forward, be determined. Come to understand, Lord, who you are and how you want to bless our lives. It's really, Lord, because of who you are. And I think our past experiences will teach us how awesome you can be for our lives. And that's why today I come to you. To ask you to lead us, to guide us, to bless us. You've prospered us so far. And if there be any need, Heavenly Father, it's not time to deviate. It's not time to take our eyes away from it. It's time to stay focused. Because we know the answer's on its way. And I'm back on the fact that song that was sung years ago. While I was on my knees, I knew the answer was on its way. For those going through a trying time right now, allow us to get in fellowship with you. And let the truth come alive. Let the power of Almighty God come through for us. Let us be strong and determined and find conviction in our hearts. And now more than ever, run toward the ultimate goal with Jesus Christ. And when our day is finished, every day we could say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you for another day. Thank you for your blessings. Thank you for protection over our children. Thank you, Lord, for the blessings to those who are in need. It's a thank you mode, a mindset, an attitude. Because truth produces victory. Victory comes to those who believe and wait upon the Lord, who wait upon you. We go forward with more determination now than ever. God, shield us. Holy Spirit, lead us as we go. As we walk through life, Lord, and we're being challenged. Our mindsets, our attitudes are being challenged by the deceiver. Using deceiving moments or ways, Lord, to try to get us to walk away. Allow us to be able to see right through it. Understand on the promise of Jesus Christ. And to know this morning that indeed greater is he that is in us than he is in the world. We go forward. Thank you, Jesus. For your word. For your word is the truth, and the truth will set us free. I glorify your holy name because of who you are. Of who you were, who you are, who you're going to be. Past, present, and future, you are our Lord. We thank you, Jesus. We glorify your name in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Thank you for this moment. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your blessing. Give us a blessing, I ask, in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Well, there's a lot more to this message, but I'm going to get a little bit of time so you'll understand all of us. I'm going to be seated. And don't turn Facebook off because I have an announcement to make to Facebook and to everybody that's here. Next Sunday at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, we're going to have one of a kind things, I think. We're probably the only church that does this. But because I deal so much with funerals, and I see how devastating it can be, and especially when the time comes to pay, how crazy it can get at that time. I've talked to people in the past, say, oh, Pastor, when I die, God's going to provide. Yes, to your family, they're going to pay. That's all sent down. And others say, well, don't worry about it, Pastor. I got $10,000, 10,000 life insurance. You know that you better die that really quick for $10,000 to cover it all. Because if the cost is going right now, it'll take about $10,000 and maybe a little bit more to get the funeral home and the cemetery. It's reality. That's what we're going to do. We're going to have a presentation of pre-need here next Sunday at 5 in the afternoon here at the church. Invitation to those watching on Facebook, those that are here present with us, to be with us at that time. You don't have to buy, but come and educate yourself. Prepare yourself to what's forthcoming, to what's ahead of you in your life. Now, what I need to know this morning from the people who are present, who are watching over Facebook, you need to contact us through our page in the next 24 hours if you plan to attend this session. I need a head count because guess what they're going to do for us? They're going to cater us. They're going to have a meal for us. And for all the people that come. And he said, well, Pastor, I'm not going to buy, but I'm hungry. Well, come on. We're going to be here at 5 o'clock next Sunday afternoon. Can I see a show of hands and give me fingers how many would be coming at that time? How many from one, really two, need a head count? Two, five, how many, Sandra? Okay, that's 7. 5 of you?
I want
to say. Okay, that's 12. Okay, that's 12 for right now. Anybody else who's going to come to this session?
Mom, I know you don't got a plan.
2, 14.
We need 15 people to get food. Come on.
Yeah, I'm going to do a head count. I got to have it. Jake's got to give a head count. By Tuesday, you got to tell him how many. And if we say 12, but we have 14, the last two don't get to eat anything. All right, we just make sure. So get a hold of us that way. But as of right now, Jake is likely to have about 12 for sure out of this service.
Okay.
That will be coming. And I told him sometime between 12 and 20 maybe. We still have this family service to do. So, like I said, you don't have to be part of this church. But if you're going to come, bring a friend, bring a neighbor, bring a family member. You need to take care of this people. You believe it. You believe it. Because that allows you also to put everything you want. That stops a lot of arguing in the families. This is what my mom wanted. She wanted these flowers, she wanted this castor, she wanted this, she wanted that, the other, and it's there. You walk in and Jacob just signed the contract, and we're good. And we're good. So do yourself a favor, and especially do it for your family. Make sure everything's already done, taken care of. That day when the time comes, and if Jesus doesn't come soon, it's going to happen, people. The most sure thing in your life and mine is if Jesus doesn't come, we're going to die. That's the most sure thing. So make arrangements. Preset. And right now, you can at least do it in payments until the time comes. So you've been asked, people on Facebook, through Facebook, contact us for our page and let us know if you plan to come. Because we do need to know. We need to have a head count. By Tuesday, Jake?
Yeah, we can do Tuesday.
Tuesday?
I'll let her know.
Yeah, because I don't want to prolong it because then people wait till the very end. We have till Tuesday to give a head count. Okay? Okay, people on Facebook, God bless you. God be with you. Have a very blessed week. Do you need an usher? Okay.